I want to thank you very much. Thanks, Sarah, for the invitation to be here today. I think this is a great idea, and I think getting people together in the social enterprise system is really important. And to touch on some important topics during the day like this is just vital. I've worked in an industry for the last more than 40 years now, as it started in high school, that has been undergoing almost constant change since the day I entered it. When I started in libraries, libraries were basically books and magazines and newspapers. We might have some LP records. We might have some 16 millimeter films available. We might have some other kinds of realia, that we, as we call it, things that we have that we could check out. But basically, the stereotype image of what a library was, of books and magazines, was pretty much accurate. That was really what we had. We were operated like minimum security penitentiaries. You came in and you followed our rules or else. We had the ultimate say on whether or not. It's like you didn't argue with the librarian for the same reason you didn't argue with the waitress. You know, you didn't want her messing up your food. You didn't want us messing up your information. If you had to do a paper, if you needed some information on business or how to fix your car, you wanted to have a good relationship with the librarian. Well, over the last few years, we've gone through an amazing amount of change in this field. And we started out really, really, really bad at it. Really bad. I mean, slow to see what was happening in communities and how the technology was changing and how people approached and used information was changing. And it took us a long time to latch on to the change and figure out how to make it work for us instead of against us. And what I want to talk to you today about is about how to manage change. Through all of these processes, we've come to realize some important things and about how we face and how we deal with change. And one of the key things we've discovered is that it's not the change itself, it's the run-up to it and how it's implemented that has as much to do with change management as the actual changes themselves. So what has been some of the changes we've gone through? Well, it started out with the collections, all right? About the time I came into libraries was about the time that videotape came out, VHS and Beta. And so there was this big controversy in public libraries about whether or not that was actually something that libraries should offer. Should we be competing with Blockbuster? Should we be competing out there with ourselves, with how we use our money? Slowly, we started to think about how we could add other things to the collections to make them more interesting. One of the things I did in the Buffalo and Erie County Public Library, when I was in high school and college, I was the one person on staff who knew how to fix ViewMasters. Remember ViewMasters? They were like the original virtual reality. Yeah, you held them up, you got those little 3D pictures, a stereopticon with really cool pictures, basically. And so that was one of those first things that we added. Oh my God, there are toys in the library. And it took a while for that to sink in. But as we started adding these new things, we started to have a broader idea of who our audience was as well. That started us thinking about collections in general. How can we connect people with information most effectively? That was a major change, because it used to be the only way to connect people with information was to give them a book or a microfilm. Print, basically, one way or another. Slowly, that started to evolve, though, as information became more ubiquitous because of the web, because of all of the different ways we had to get information starting in the early 1990s. We had to start thinking about what we were actually collecting and why. Why do we do this? Why do we have this stuff? And the thoughts started to change from the collections themselves to how we use space and what we use space for. So libraries became not so much warehouses or repositories of information as they became community centers, places where people could do continuing education, lifelong learning that wasn't involved in a formal education system. It became a place where people could indulge their hobbies and their interests in an informal or a formal way. New book clubs got formed, things around cooking or things around knitting or things around drinking. We have three book clubs that meet in bars in Delaware County, for example. But even that was only the beginning, because it's moved from there to an idea of not collections not even space, but how do you make connections in the community? And I thought Diego hit this really well when he was talking about how they pulled their supporters together and how they worked with the media. And what I'm going to be talking about is how you do this kind of change when your hair is not on fire. Because it's really difficult sometimes to see how that fits. This is one of my favorite quotes from Charles Darwin. It's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent that survives. It is the one that is most adaptable to change. Darwin never said survival of the fittest, by the way. That was not his phrase. That was actually Herbert Spencer applying evolution to social issues, and we got social Darwinism. Darwin knew that it was about adaptability. It was about how you face the change, how you add a different dimension to what you're doing, how you can adapt to that. If you can adapt to that, you can have a long and healthy run as a species. If you can't, you die off. It's pretty much as simple as that. Douglas Adams, who wrote the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxies, which is one of my favorite books of all time, had one of the best quotes I've ever had about change. I want to read it directly. I'm going to try not to read my notes mostly today. But his quote was, "Anything that's in the world when you're born is normal and ordinary and is just a natural part of the way the world works. Anything that's invented between when you're 15 and 35 is new and exciting and revolutionary, and you can probably get a career in it. Anything invented after you're 35 is against the natural order of things." So I think that that's a really good summary of how institutions as well as people face change. And let's face it, change is hard. Change is not something that comes naturally to people. If you're in an organization that's changing because suddenly you're on the wrong end of a microphone, like Diego was talking about with what happened with Planned Parenthood, you've got one sort of a change element that you've got to face. But most organizations, if they're lucky, don't have that kind of a change structure. Their change may be something that's going over a long period of time. Look at the March of Dimes. They were created to fight polio. Basically, polio was beaten in the 1950s. Now, they still had people who had suffered from polio who were going to have long-term effects from it that they were helping. And there was still the goal of eradicating polio worldwide, which is very close to being done, thanks to the March of Dimes and Rotary and the Gates Foundation, a number of other groups. How do you keep evolving the mission if you want to stay around as an organization? Well, March of Dimes has done it by broadening their idea of what they do to fighting birth defects rather than simply fighting polio. And that's made an organization that survived longer. But they had time to work on that. They've had time to think about that over the long haul. And what I want to talk to you today about is how you make those changes, how you can do it in a way that is both mindful and humane. So if your hair is on fire, if the state is threatening to defund your organization, you have one set of issues. But if you're seeing and you're looking at the long horizon of what it is you do, you have a different set. And this is what I'm going to be talking about today. Why is change so bloody tough? A lot of it is because people feel they know what they're doing and what they're doing now. I know how to use this. I know how to do this. I have contacts in the community that let me do this. But if we're going to go in a different direction, who am I in that new world? What do I need to know? Am I going to still be viable in that community? Is what I know still useful? Is what I can do still useful? All of those questions create a sense of ennui in people. They don't know what they're supposed to be doing. And for that reason, sometimes, they'll fight change. Other times, people will fight change because they're disappointed optimists. When somebody says, "We tried that in 1997 and it didn't work," frequently they're right. It was tried in 1997 and it didn't work. And they remember what it looked like when that article was on the front page of the Dispatch that said the organization wasted $50,000 trying this new thing that didn't work. And they don't want the organization dragged through the mud again. So when you think about that, you think about how do you bring folks along that are either scared of where they're going to fit in a new order or they're just resistant to being dragged through the same issues again. And that's, again, part of what we're going to be talking about. But the fact is, no matter how tough change is, it is vital. As Edward Deming said, change is not necessary. It is not necessary to change. Survival is not mandatory. And we've seen that. I mean, how many of you are going to drive an Oldsmobile to stop at Woolworths on your way home tonight so that you can pick your Netflix videos out of your mailbox, right? Things do change. Things do change. And unless you've really adapted, you do stand the chance of being left behind. And there's a simple reason for this. You know, basically, it's Newtonian. And Newton's law said that things will continue on an unimpeded path unless they're affected by an outside agency. And what we usually say is bodies in motion tend to remain in motion, bodies at rest tend to remain at rest. Well, change is that great big boulder that comes in from left field and knocks you off your course. So inertia is what keeps things going in one place. Change is what knocks you out of that course. And again, that whole idea is frightening. So for some people, the idea of completely reconceptualizing what they do is truly exciting. For other people, it's a real draw, a real drag. They don't want to get involved in that. They want to be able to do what they're doing and do it well until time immemorial. But it's that those people in the middle you need to bring along. And one of the things that I think is really important to this is thinking in a different way about what it is you do. And this was one of the hardest changes we've had to make in libraries over the years. Our thinking, our strategic planning, our building plans, our levy campaigns have all been built from the inside out. We think about what it is the library does and how can we do more of it? How can we do it better? How can we do it in different places? How can we give more of the same kind of service that we've been doing and continue to move along in that path, that uninterrupted path that we talk about? What's happened over the last couple of years, and this has been done through the work of a couple of big institutions, the Aspen Institute and the Harwood Institute, has been to change our thinking from inside-out thinking to outside-in. So instead of thinking about what can the library do to help the community first, it's what is the community doing? What do people in the community care about? What are their hopes and aspirations? What are their fears? Then, what can the library do to help with that? So that our thinking is, what is this larger community that we're involved in? Who are the players? Who are the key people that we need to work with in order to be part of this society? Libraries used to see themselves as being sort of something removed from and different from the rest of the community. And we slowly came to realize that in a world where people say, well, with Google, why do we need libraries? That is not a valid place to be. And so we've been forced, not, you know, again, it's not one of these things where suddenly somebody's sticking a microphone in your face and you're faced with immediate defunding, but it's a long-term thing. It's like what Major League Baseball is facing in terms of the age of its audience. You know, we were always going to have a certain age group that was going to continue to use libraries because they started using them when they were little kids. But what are we doing for the current crop of kids? What are we doing for their parents and their grandparents? How does that fit in? So, again, this inside out versus outside in thinking has really affected libraries quite a bit. And what it's come down to, and we did this in the Columbus Metro Library a couple of years ago. We've done this in the Delaware County Library back when I was still consulting, before I was director there. And that is to do community visioning workshops. Where is the community now? And you spend the time talking about the community until you get to the very end. You don't bring up the library. You don't talk about what the library does and how great the library is and how much it needs more money or how many wonderful things it's done. Instead, you talk about what the community's doing. What do people care about here? And then, at the very end, you bring in what can we do with the library to help push that forward? What are the community's greatest fears? What are its greatest hopes? Great. What can the library do to work with that? A few years ago, I was in a town out west doing a one-day community visioning workshop to try to create a strategic plan for this library. And I was with a group of community leaders. There were some people, business people, members of the board of the library, a couple of just regular library users, and library staff. And I asked them, tell me about this city. What's the city's kind of self-image? How does it see itself? And the people kind of hemmed and hawed. They didn't really want to answer me. And finally, somebody said, this is a town where people live until they can afford to live somewhere better. And somebody else said, yeah, and isn't that a hell of a thing to try to build a library on? And I said, no, they just handed you the keys to the kingdom. If this is a community where people live until they can afford to live somewhere better, help them live somewhere better. That means create library services, the things you already know how to do, that help them do the things they want to do. There's a lot fewer of us than there are of them, so what can we do with them instead of trying to work in a different direction? So that's the kind of community look that we're trying to develop in libraries, and that's been a long haul, because we're so used to looking through the other end of the telescope. You know, we see, instead of looking at the big picture throughout what we can do, we've been trying to focus everything down to what we are and bring the public to that. That is a tough row to hoe. And so we've been trying to get away from that. So I needed a framework to think about change. I am not a really great original thinker, but I am a really good thief. I can steal from everybody. And so I got to reading John Kotter, who is a professor at Harvard in the business school there. And he's one of the few business writers I read because he can write. Most business books take one idea that would make a really good Harvard Business Review article or article in Fortune or somewhere like that and build a whole book around it, usually 300 pages and usually published by Harvard or one of the other university presses, and drive you nuts. Kotter is the opposite of that. He has really great ideas, and he builds them out in ways you can actually use them, like podcasts and articles. And this book, Our Iceberg is Melting. I don't know if you've ever heard of it, but what this is it's basically a parable. It's a picture book. You can read it in half an hour. And it's about a penguin, young penguin, who's living on this colony on an iceberg, and discovers that the iceberg, logically enough, is melting. And how does he go about convincing the other penguins in this colony that they need to move? And basically, it uses Kotter's 8-step process of change to tell the story. And like I say, you can read it in half an hour, and it'll change your life. Then you can read his longer academic books about the change, about the different steps of change, but you don't have to. It's all right there. You can read them for fun, but you don't have to. So anyway, I realized back when I started probably 10, 15 years ago that the library iceberg was melting, that what we were built on in terms of collections was just not going to sustain because it was getting easier and easier to find the stuff that we considered so important anywhere else. Libraries were built on a value proposition that was described by one of my colleagues at OCLC like this. When libraries were formed, information was expensive and it was hard to get. I don't know about you, but I grew up in a neighborhood in Buffalo where if you had gotten all of the discretionary income within a 12-block radius of where I grew up, we couldn't have afforded to buy an encyclopedia. But the library that sat right in the middle of that 12-block radius had an encyclopedia because the city decided that it was worth putting enough money into having these rare and expensive and hard to find items in one place so that the entire community could use them. So information was scarce and expensive, but time was limitless. We could do anything. You know, the city would give the library a bunch of money, or some money at least, and their job was to go out and buy stuff and put labels on the back and put Dewey Decimal numbers on it and index it and abstract and all that other stuff that librarians do, put it on the shelf, throw the doors open, and say, come on in and learn how to use this stuff. Information was scarce and expensive. Time was limitless. What's happened in the last few decades, let's say, is that that proposition has turned around 180 degrees. Information's everywhere. Look at how many people in this room are using a pad, a phone, a laptop to get information right now, or to share information, or to communicate. It's everywhere. You can't swing a baseball bat without hitting information. Okay, but what is harder to get? Time, right? Okay, so you're going home tonight. You need a loaf of bread and a quart of milk. Are you going to go to absolutely the finest grocery store in Franklin County? Or are you going to go to the one where you don't have to make a left turn? Okay? That's what I'm talking about. So that was our iceberg, and that was melting. So how could we think about how the change could go about? So I'm not going to go through all 8 steps, but I want to give some highlights on how we did this in the library field, and then maybe we'll have some time we can talk about how your icebergs are melting and how this might apply. So the first thing, which I love the hair on fire analogy that Diego used because I knew this slide was coming in this presentation. And one of the things that Cotter stresses is that you have to create a sense of urgency. There has to be some sort of reason to make a change. You don't just make a change because you feel like it. You don't just make a change because it's cool or it's what the other kids are doing. You really have to have a good reason to do it. And that sense of urgency can be an opportunity that came out of nowhere. It doesn't have to be a bad thing. You could have a donor who wants to fund something that may be a little bit outside of your regular scope. It may be that you want to create a social enterprise that's going to support your organization, but doesn't necessarily fit exactly within the mission the way it's been described in the past. It could be in libraries just the sense that, oh my God, there's information coming in forms that we're not used to using. It's not going to kill us tomorrow. Might not kill us next year, but we have to be looking at the longer scope of where what it's going to do. You have to help other people see the urgency, and you have to do it honestly. You can't create a sense of false urgency because it's like the story of the boy who cried wolf. Now, I'm never sure in this picture, I love this picture, but I'm never sure if the little guy in back is telling that guy, don't go out there, or if he said, you go see if the coast is clear. But you really have to help people see what the issues are. And then you need to gather support, and this is the thing that I thought Diego covered really brilliantly. Having your supporters lined up before you need them is really important. The people who can help you make a change, who can help introduce it, who can make it seem reasonable to people, and who have some of the oomph you need to sell your points to the community at large is really important. And my grandfather used to have this little bit of doggerel that he used to tell me. He would say, whenever you go by a church, stop in and make a visit. So when they have to drag you in, the Lord won't say, who is it? And that's what this is about. This is about making your contacts, getting to know the people in the media in your community, getting to know the people in your own professional field that you touch upon early, making those contacts, getting so that they'll answer the phone when you call, so that they'll respond to your text or your email ahead of time, not at the moment of crisis. So having that support in place ahead of time is vital. Once you know in general terms where you're going, you need to refine the vision so that people can understand it. John Cotter says, if you can't tell people about your change idea in a meaningful way in 5 minutes, you haven't thought about it enough. Now, that's not all the details. That's not the 17 different places of funding sources you're going to have to deal with to make this happen. This isn't about where you're going to physically do this stuff necessarily. This is about what the vision is and how can you make it understandable to the person you're explaining it to. You can think of this as sort of like an elevator speech, but it's a little longer than that. It's not 30 seconds, it's a few minutes. But to be able to explain the vision in a way that your colleagues, your board members, and members of the general public can understand it is really vital to do early. And it should be a positive vision of the future. You're never going to get anywhere, you're never going to get that sense of urgency and support behind you if all you're weaving constantly is a dystopian look at the future. I've had it with dystopian movies. Because to me, it's just like, why would you even bother if the future's going to suck that bad? You know, I don't want to live in the world of the Hunger Games or that sort of thing. So creating a more positive view of what you're going to be able to do in this new future is also really important. Having a sense that you still have a role, that you're still vital in this future is really, truly what gives people the motivation to keep going. And if you don't have that, what you're going to have is people who are burned out, and basically it's like working for Kmart right now or Sears. You know you're on your last legs, and you know it's dying, but it's like you got to drag yourself to the finish line. Nobody wants to be in that situation. Nobody wants to feel like what they're doing doesn't have meaning. So creating this positive vision of the future is really an important aspect of having that refined vision. And once you've done that, people can start to clarify the roles of what their role is going to be in this new world. What's my, yeah, Mike Royko, the great columnist in Chicago, used to say that the motto of the city of Chicago should be, what's in it for me? And he meant that really cynically, but I think it's really important when you're trying to create a change for people to understand what is in it for them. What is your role going to, if you're a staff person, what is your role going to be in this new reality? How are we going to take the skills that you have and apply them to what we need to do in 2017 and 2018 and 2025? The skills that you might have learned in 1990 or 1995, how do they apply? And if they totally don't apply, how are you going to help people get across, get the education, the continuing training that they need in order to stay relevant? Having an understanding of what the roles are going to be in the future helps people buy into that future. If they don't know, what's the first thing they're going to do? They're going to assume the worst. I don't have a role in this. Or they don't care about my role or what I've done. All of these things I've done in the past don't mean anything. So one of the things that we always, that when I was working as a consultant and that I've done in libraries, that I'm going to be doing again next week in a library in Long Island, is what we call a timeline exercise. What you do is you grab yourself a piece of wrapping paper that has the grid on the back. Okay, you know the kind I'm talking about. You lay out a timeline on one of those lines, on one of the horizontal lines. You put a date on the left side, my left, your right, this where you're looking at this, but the left side, that's the earliest date where somebody in your organization came to work for it. So if your earliest employee started in 1983, that is the right axis, the right end of the line, left end of the line. The right end of the line is today. And what you do is, on the bottom of the line, you write in changes that have already happened. Here's where we put in our first computer system. Here's where we moved to the new offices. Here's where we got that big grant that let us do X. Here's where the new executive director came in. Here's where we got the award from the National Association for what we did. You fold that up so that you can't see the bottom line. And in a staff meeting, you have people come in and put dots on the year where they started. And in the staff meeting, you fold down the bottom so they can see the kinds of change that have already gotten them there. What's already happened that you've lived through? Not only, and you might even extend it to things that have happened in the outside world that affect you, like when did we first go online and when was the internet available? When did we add online registration for our events? When did Google come up? And you've been through all of these changes already. And if you hadn't, you wouldn't be having that staff meeting in 2016. What got you there should be able to take you into the next generation of what you're going to do if you prep right, if you use your people well. So there's basically two key ways that we want to talk about communicating as you talk about what your vision is and what the change is going to be. And the first is you want to communicate for understanding. So people really do buy into, people really do understand what the change is going to be. How radical is it? How much will it affect what I do? How much will we be going forward with this? But the second kind is every bit as important, and that's communicating for buy-in. You want to make sure that people have enough information so that they can buy into what you're saying and where you're going. And this also helps weed out the people who really are going to be the dead enders, who don't want to change and are going to, you know, drag their feet as much as possible to keep it from happening. Both of these are important because they continually reinforce what it is that you're trying to do. However, and when you're doing this communication, aiming for the heart is really important. Cotter stresses this over and over again. And what this means is not necessarily sentimentality, but what it means is, if you're working in a not-for-profit organization, like a library, like an arts gallery, whatever, you've got a mission that you're doing. And tying whatever change you want to do back to that mission is vital. Because for most people who work in a not-for-profit world, they're doing it as much because they're mission-driven as it is because Walmart wasn't hiring the week they needed a job. Okay? They're there because they care. And if you can tie the change back to why that's happening and why that's important for your mission, that's really important. And it really helps people understand and buy into what you're saying. at OCLC, which is the big library, International Library Cooperative that Sarah and I both used to work for here in town, the mission was furthering access to the world's information and reducing the rate of costs to individual libraries. And we constantly went back to that mission as we evaluated and tried to sell internally new products and projects and ideas. That was something that just drove us, and that had been actually codified by the person who started OCLC back in 1967. Even as late as 2016, 2015, they're still using that mission as the way to aim for the heart. I did that in a meeting of vice presidents, and somebody said, he just pulled out the Bible. Because that is how we consider that importance there. But you know, it's interesting. What we do in some ways is we can sometimes shoot ourselves in the foot with this when we're making changes. But this was, I thought, a brilliant strategy that came up. The Troy, Michigan Public Library was threatened with closing due to they lost a levy campaign. And so the city council decided they were just going to zero fund the library, get ready to close, forget about it. The board and the community went to the council and said, give us one more chance to pass this levy. The council gave them like bridge funding to last for a couple of months so they could run one more campaign. Once that was approved, these signs started showing up in the community. Vote to close the library on the Tuesday. The book burning party will be Friday. There was a Facebook page all about the book burning party. They started advertising for food vendors and musicians and entertainment to come for the book burning party. The community was outraged. They went nutsy over this thing. Nobody could figure out who was doing it because the library swore they weren't doing it. When the vote, about a week before the vote finally came up, it was revealed that it was an advertising agency that was trying this out. Had nothing to do with the library. They were doing it strictly on their own. It was McCann Erickson in Chicago was doing this campaign to see how it would work. There's something kind of creepy about it. It almost feels like aliens landing in your community to see how people will react. But what happened was they passed their levy. The library's still open. They passed it they doubled the percentage of registered voters who voted in that election as opposed to the ones when the library lost. They passed it by like 57% positive. And so a lot of the credit went to this very thing. And I think it gets to the point of something that came up in the old TV show Mad Men. If you don't like what's being said, change the conversation. Now the library didn't change this conversation, but McCann Erickson did. They took it from being a vote about, do I want to pay a little bit more taxes for the library, to being, do I believe in book burning? Quite a different conversation. And it was a way of thinking about change, thinking about what it is we're doing that was really important. You can fall into some traps with communication, though. And I've got three that I want to suggest. The first is overselling, which is trying to make your staff believe that whatever you're doing is going to be the greatest thing in the history of your particular profession. I can't go in and tell people that if we make a change that the Delaware County Library is going to go from having about 60% of our population registered to 100%. It's just not going to happen. I can't oversell that because if it doesn't work, if it doesn't get to that, my credibility is shot and people will be that much more resistant to the next change. The second mistake you can make is under-communicating, that if I tell you once about something, you're going to know it and you're going to incorporate it. I worked with a library director in the Pacific Northwest who prided herself on the community service that her library did, the great customer service that they offered. So I was consulting with them. I went in a day early. I used to do this occasionally. And before anybody knew me, I would just wander through a couple of the libraries and see what it was like, what the experience was like. Service was terrible, absolutely terrible. Nobody spoke to me, nobody, not even a greeting, nobody asked me if they could help me. Now, I'm a, late middle-aged man. I wandered into the children's area just to see if anybody, I didn't, talk to any kids, I didn't do anything wrong. I just wandered, and nobody would speak to me. So I go and I tell the director this the next day, and she's like horrified. She said, but I sent out a memo about customer service, and then we put it on the website. Yeah, and look at the results. You didn't follow up. You didn't put into any kind of a concept what you meant by good customer service. There wasn't enough communication to actually make people internalize this. to make them actually be able to say back to you what this kind of good customer service meant. And so that kind of under-communication left them in the lurch. There is one thing to watch out for, though. See, people will tell you that they haven't gotten enough information when what they really mean is, I don't like the idea. You know, they'll use that as an excuse instead of actually not, they'll claim that they don't have enough information when in fact they just want to stop it. The third communication trap is the echo chamber. And I see this in the political structure right now. It is so obvious. All I got to do is say two things, MSNBC and Fox. If you listen to MSNBC almost exclusively for your news, you will have one view of the world. If you watch Fox almost exclusively for your news, you will have a very different view of the same world. And if all you get is things that already confirm what you think, you're really not getting the whole story. If you only surround yourself with people who agree with you or who think that your ideas are working, you're never going to really test those ideas in the real world. And when they don't work, or if they don't work, once they get out there, you're going to wonder why. It's like the people who said, I don't know anybody who would have voted for George Bush, or I don't know anybody who would have voted for Bernie Sanders. You really, that's probably true. And it's your own fault. So those three communications traps can all be fatal. Once you've gotten this kind of sense that people are on their way, you've got to let them do it. We see, especially when things get tough, there's a natural tendency to hunker down. All right, get yourself in the bunker, hold it with just a couple of people that you really trust, or even just by yourself, and then you start to feel oppressed, you start to feel burned out. And what, in fact, if you let the people you work with, the people that you've grown to trust over time, take action, you wouldn't have that sense. You'd also be getting information coming in from a lot of different sources that could truly help you. You need to tear down the barriers that they face, whether these are mental barriers or physical barriers. You know, if there's something, people don't have the tools that they need to do the job, if they don't have the support that they need, it's your responsibility to help pull those barriers down. And the more you can do that, the more credibility you gain, and the faster people can get things done. Giving up worrying about the small stuff, we refer to that in libraries as the twiddly bits, the little stuff that's around the edges that don't really affect anything but make people happy because they do them. We are in libraries a profession of perfectionists. We would rather eat dirt than have a mistake in a catalog record, which is kind of ridiculous because 80% of the people who use public libraries never look at the catalog. And most of the changes that we make in the catalog don't affect it even for the 20% of the people who can. You know, so, but getting over the people who don't do things exactly the way you would have done them and letting them actually do it the way they feel most comfortable, as long as they're not doing anything illegal or immoral, let them get it done. You need to celebrate those short-term wins. It's really important that people know that they're on the right track. And too often it's we got that, but oh my God, there's this big thing coming up and we're never gonna get through that. You've gotta actually celebrate those short-term wins. You gotta tell people that when they're doing well and let them know how important those short-term wins are to getting to the bigger picture. And you have to recognize your contributors. You gotta make sure that the people who are, and that picture is from the Our Iceberg is Melting book. You've gotta let them know that you support them and that you appreciate what you've done. Just as important is you got to recognize the right people. If somebody gets recognized who just sat on the sidelines, again, you're destroying credibility. You got to make sure, you know, there's that old joke about the stages of a project are the, you know, and the last one is that you lionize the uninvolved. You don't want to do that. You want to make sure that you're actually recognizing the people who helped. You want to make sure you don't declare victory too soon. I think we all remember this picture. And I think you want to make sure that you don't start thinking that because of those small-term wins, you've gotten the whole thing done. Every step is a step in the right direction, but declaring final victory when you're talking about change is probably not a good idea. Because change is a process. Change is an ongoing process. It's not an event. I mean, there are certain life-changing events, yes. You know, I retired, that's an event, that's a change. I change jobs, I win the lottery. Those are events that cause change, but the change in the organization is long-term and evolving. You continue to build on the success. You say, okay, this worked and this worked, so let's put something on top of that that continues to build on that. And you learn from your failures. You know, there's a real hard tendency that when something goes wrong, you go, oh, Jesus, I'll never do that again. The better thing to do is, oh, my God, that went wrong. What can we learn from that? How can we make that loss not necessarily a win, but at least a learning experience? You know, what did we do? How could we have gotten better funding? How could we have attracted more people to an event? How could we have gotten our word out more effectively in the media? And using those things to learn from instead of just as, thou be dragons, is a really important step. Don't lose focus. It's really easy to lose focus. Also avoid Schadenfreude. You know, that taking joy in the misfortune of others, like the young lady in the back there. It's like, ooh, better him than me. There is that sense that, oh my God, they cut their funding, but mine's okay. You want to make sure that you realize that next time they could be coming for you. The next step, and this is one of the harder ones, especially if you have a changing staff, or if you have people that stay forever, is how do you make something stick within the organization? How do you actually get it worked into the culture so that people can't imagine doing their work without it? And that basically takes time. That's something that, you know, most changes, you can't just put it in place, get it up and running, and then walk away from it. It's something you have to constantly nurture in order to make it stay. Because culture eats strategy for breakfast. And if you make these changes but don't get them into the culture, as soon as you turn your back or as soon as you move on to a different position or another issue, it's going to backslide back into where you were. So that's one of the things we've had to watch in libraries is that when we make some of these changes and you have visionary leaders, people like Pat Leszczynski here at the Columbus Metro Library, Andy Venable, who just passed away, but who was the director of the Cleveland Public Library, made huge changes in that library. The woman who is the director in Seattle, who made big changes, and the key was that they stuck around long enough to make sure that it got into the culture, because if it didn't, it would have been real easy for it to go away. When I took over as the director of the Fairfield County Library in Lancaster back in the 80s, one of the first things I did was I put a notebook out on the old hardwood card catalog. And the notebook, each piece of cardboard in the notebook was divided into two parts. If you've got an issue with the library, tell me here and I'll answer you on the bottom part of the card. And I used that for the 5 years I was director there as a way of having a more direct interaction with the public. My staff hated it. Because a lot of the comments would be like, I came in and I couldn't get what I wanted, or the lady at the circulation desk was really mean to me, and things like that. So they would get really upset about things like that were written in there. So I left there on a Sunday. I went back the following week to pick up some stuff I'd left, and the notebook was gone. I mean, gone. It had been burned, I think. It was absolutely gone. So that was a change that didn't stick. One of the things you have to know about change is this great curve. I love this curve because it explains so much. And that is the diffusion of innovation. On any change, now Everett Rogers talked about this not in terms of technology, but in terms of any kind of social or cultural change. At the very front, you're going to have the innovators. Those are the folks who camp out in front of the Apple store a day or two early in order to buy the new phone or the new watch or the new iMac, whatever. They're the ones who always want to be at the front line of change. They love change. They love change for change's sake. Then you've got the early adopters. Those are the people who go into the Apple store on the Saturday after those people have lined up, buy it off the shelf, and walk out. They want to be at the front line, but they're not necessarily the ones who will, you know, open an artery to be the first ones in. The middle group is the really important group, and that's the majority. First, you got these people who will come along. Like, I would consider myself generally in that early majority group. You know, I moved to an iPhone after having a BlackBerry for a lot of years. I moved to those kinds of things. You know, I moved to an iPad instead of a Palm Pilot, that's that kind of thing. So you like the change. You like, once people have gotten most of the kinks out, you want to jump in. Then you've got the late majority. The early majority are the wait and see people. The late majority are the wait and wait. They really want to make sure this thing's bulletproof before they jump in, but they will jump in. And then you get the laggards. Those are the wait and never. Those are the people who hold up forever waiting to before that they'll go into a change. What happens in libraries, and I can't speak for your organizations, but what happens in libraries way too often is we don't feel like we can actually make a change until that whole rat has passed through the python, until everybody, including the laggards, have come along on it. But the key, and what Rogers discovered and what Moore talked about afterwards, was no. If you get those first two groups, and you can get through that little chasm between when the early adopters and the innovators jump in and when the early majority starts, once you've jumped that chasm, you're there. You will pick up the early majority and the late majority. They will bring them along. And once you get to about the top of that peak, or even just on the upslope there, you've won. Move it. Do it. Because you've reached critical mass. If you wait till the laggards have every I dotted, every T crossed, you'll never get anything done. And so being ready to move when you get to that point, when you've got that early majority behind you, you're in tall clover. So all of this is about change. And all of this prep work eventually devolves into something you actually have to do. And this was brought home to me when I worked at the American Library Association. I had an office manager named Don Wood. And I've cleared this with Don that he's okay with me telling this story because I'm going to characterize him in a way. And Don is the calmest human being I know who's not doing drugs. Don is a practicing Buddhist. He's very, just incredibly calm. Don just doesn't let anything get to him. So I decided to test his calm by putting him in charge of our committee structure in the division of the American Library Association I worked in. And his job was to make sure that the committees did the stuff that they needed to do so that we could do our annual conference and our meetings between those conferences. So one day, Don stormed into my office. Now, Don never stormed. Don glides. Don, if he's really upset, he'll walk with purpose. But Don never storms, but he stormed into my office and he said, five crows are sitting on a fence. Three of them decide to leave. How many are left? I went, two? He said, no, five. They've decided, but they haven't done a mm-mm thing. And he ran out of my office. The whole point is you can do all the deciding you want, but until you actually act, none of this makes any sense. None of this actually takes effect. So change is about picking those right times when you can make change, when you can move forward, when you can see that gap in the fiber that's let you move forward. But you have to be willing to do it when that opportunity comes up. Thank you very much for the warm reception, and good luck. Thank you.